Hello. In today's video, I want to go over the process of setting up a new WordPress website on an AWS EC2 instance. I'm already logged into my AWS account, so we're all set and good to go. So EC2, or Elastic Compute Cloud, is the AWS solution to create and manage virtual machines. We're going to need one, as it's going to be the server that will run everything. So let's open the EC2 menu. And let's launch a new instance. Now, you can, of course, create a new server and then install WordPress by yourself. But by using the AWS Marketplace, we get access to a myriad of pre-configured servers for all kinds of needs and purposes. And among these pre-configured servers, there are WordPress servers. I recommend that unless you really have out-of-the-ordinary needs, you go with one of these off-the-shelf solutions, as they are really tried and true, and will most likely prevent suboptimal configuration or security problems. So I'm going to look for WordPress. And it says that no results were found in the quick catalog, but there are results in the AWS Marketplace. So let's see them. And if you go through the results, you can see that there are all kinds of variants and options. For example, there is an Nginx-based solution instead of Apache. There is a multi-site server and many other options. I'm going to choose the first option that is offered by Bitnami, which happens to be the first option overall. Bitnami is a tool that installs application stacks on top of the operating system, and the WordPress stack is one of the stacks they offer. As you can see, it's based on a Debian server. I remember that in the past, Bitnami offered WordPress on top of Ubuntu, but to be honest, we're hardly going to interact with the server directly, so it won't matter too much. And moreover, if the Bitnami team decided to make the switch, who am I to argue? We can also see the hourly rate for different instances. Here, for example, is the T3A.small, which I'm going to choose in a second, and it's priced at almost 2 cents per hour. We now need to choose an instance type. Many people would probably go with a free tier option, which is available for 1 year when you create your AWS account, which is totally fine, but do take into account that one processor and 1 GB of RAM, even though sufficient to run a small WordPress website, is quite meager and might hurt performance with bigger websites. As I said, I'll go with T3A.small. We can specify the size of the disk that will be attached to the server. I leave it at 10 GB. Let's launch the instance. We now need to create a key pair. The key pair consists of two distinct keys, a private key and a public key. We're going to download the private key in a minute. We will store it on our local computer, and we're going to need it whenever we want to connect to the server. The public key will reside on the server itself. It will be automatically placed there as soon as the server is created. If you already created a key pair in the past, you can use it. Or you can just create a new key pair, which is what I am going to do. Okay, I downloaded the private key. Notice that it will not be available to download anymore. So make sure you store it somewhere safe, so you don't lose access to your server. Great. After a few seconds, our instance should be ready. Let's get back to the list of instances. And we can see that our instance is running. I'll name it so it's easier to recognize it. And down here, we can see the public IP address of the server. We are being warned that the connection isn't private, which is to be expected, as we didn't set up SSL yet. But as I'm not going to provide any sensitive information, it's safe to proceed to the website. And our WordPress website is up and running. And it required about 0 configuration. Let's move on to connecting a domain name to the server. This is done with the root53 tool. we need to create a new hosted zone. Each hosted zone is in charge of connecting one domain name to one specific IP address. I'm going to assume that you already have your domain name, so just type it in. You can also write a short description to help you recognize the hosted zone. And we want it to be a public hosted zone because we want our website to be accessible. By the way, each hosted zone costs 50 cents per month. Great, the hosted zone was created. We now need to create a new record for it. It's going to be an A record, which is an IPv4 record. A records are arguably the most important ones for a DNS server, as they map the domain name to the specific IP address. When we create a new record, an A record is the default, but make sure that that's the selected record type. And in the value field, I'm going to put the public IP address of our server. It also makes a lot of sense to connect the www subdomain to the server's address. As for the NS and SOA records, just leave them as they are. We now need to make sure that the NS record, the name server record, matches what we have with our DNS hosting service. Almost always, this service is provided by your domain registrar. That's the company you registered your domain with. Many people use GoDaddy or Namecheap, but you can also buy domains from Amazon. And that's what I did. But even though the interface might be a bit different, if your domain is registered with a different registrar, the idea is always the same. So I'll open the DNS management interface. And here we can see the name servers. Whoever your registrar is, they give you an option to edit your name servers. And these name servers need to match what we have in the NS record. So in the bottom, I have the records, where we just added the A records. And here is the NS record. In the top, I manage the name server of the domain itself. If they don't match, copy the four values from the NS record. It's important that you don't change the NS record itself. Change only the name servers on the DNS provider. We now need to wait for this update to propagate. It can take anything from a few minutes to more than a day. But in any case, once the propagation is done, we will be able to access the website using the domain. So let's see if I'm lucky and it's already working. Whoa, it's already working. I got really lucky. But as I said before, your mileage may vary. And now when I access the domain, I'm presented to our AWS WordPress website. To edit the content of our website, we need to access the management view. To do that, we access the WP admin URL. By the way, you can also access it with WP login, or login, or admin. They all take you to the same page. We now need the credentials. To get them, let's connect to our server. We're going to do it with PowerShell. We're now going to need the private key that we downloaded when we started the server. In my case, it's in the Downloads folder. So in PowerShell, let's change directory to the Downloads folder. And we can list the files in this folder with the ls command. And here's the private key with its PEM extension. Of course, if your private key is in a different folder, change to that folder. Or move it back to the Downloads folder. So let's connect to our server via SSH. We now specify the SSH target, which is Bitnami at the IP address of the server. And then we need to specify the location of the private key. Since we are currently in the folder that holds the private key, we just need to specify the file name. And once I type a few letters, I can use tab for auto-completion. Since this is the first time I'm accessing this server, I'm given a warning. So I just type in yes and press enter. And we're now connected to the server. As you can see, it says Bitnami at the IP. Which means that we're now interacting with the server. If we list the contents here using ls, we can see that there is a file called Bitnami credentials. So let's see its contents. And we can see that the username is user and the password is this. Let's use these credentials to connect to our website. And we logged in. Let's now set up SSL to our website. Because seeing this, as soon as you try to access a website, well, one could claim that it's not top-notch user experience. Since we're using a Bitnami stack, it's going to be pretty much painless. They package a tool called BN Cert tool, which probably stands for Bitnami Certificate Tool, and we just need to run it. We now need to provide the domain or domains to which we want to create the SSL certificate. I recommend that to prevent typos, you paste the name instead of typing it. The tool suggests to add the www version as well. I want it, so I'll go with yes. We now ask if we want to redirect HTTP requests to HTTPS. So I'll go with yes again. And now we're asked if we want to redirect the non-www version to the www version. It's a matter of choice, I guess. But personally, I think that starting your URL with www is great if you're in the 90s. So I'll go with no. And then we're asked about the reverse direction. And here I'll go with yes, and this redirection will get rid of the www. It now lists everything it's going to do. You can skim through it, but basically it says that it's going to generate a free SSL certificate. We now need to provide an email. And we need to agree to the terms of use. Okay, it's doing its thing. It's going to take a few moments. And it's done. And when we try to access the website now, we can see that the protocol is HTTPS, and we also have our lock. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.